Amish is inarguably India's most popular mythmaker. The young, as well as the old, love his fantasy retellings of Hindu epics and look forward to reading his upcoming releases. No wonder that his latest release, Raavan, which is the third book of the Ram Chandra series, is already a record-breaking bestseller. Let's meet the country's literary pop star and understand what makes him a phenomenal success. Hi Amish, welcome on the show.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.
Let's start the conversation with Raavan, the enemy of Aryabhatta. Tell us about it.
This is the story, and the Ram Chandra series is a 5-book series. So the first 3 books are in a multilinear narrative. The fourth and fifth book are in a common narrative. So the first book, Ram Saino Vishwaku, is from the birth of Lord Ram to the kidnapping of Lady Sita. Sita, warrior of Mithila, is from her birth to her kidnapping. And Raavan, who has just been released, which you've kindly displayed here, thank you very much, is from his birth to the time he kidnaps Lady Sita. And so all the first 3 books end at the same point, and the fourth book onwards is a common narrative. So what you get in Raavan, enemy of Aryabhatta, is his backstory from his childhood. What made him into the man we know him as. But I'd also like to clarify that the man we know him as in modern India is also, we see him in a very simplistic way. You know, we're tending to see things in black and white. A lot of it driven by the television serials, which have portrayed him as just a demented, violent thug, basically. Which is not the way he was portrayed in the original Valmiki Ramayana. And not just that, most of the other ancient versions of the Ramayana as well. There were nuanced takes on him. So his bad points were obviously shown, but his good points weren't ignored either. The fact that he was a scholar, that he was exceptionally well-read, that he was a brilliant musician, that he was a very good administrator. It was Sone Ki Lanka because he was a good administrator. So those strengths were also shown. And that's what makes him truly a complex, deep man. He's not just a thug. He's not just a violent man. Genuinely talented, deep, complex, lots of anger management issues, huge ego.
And they've been there since childhood. So yeah, I read in the book.
Yeah, that's, you know, if it's one of the things, I mean, one of the, you know, people, the early readers of the book, and she wrote that in a review, in a sort of review in a paper where she wrote an article on Raavan, but she wrote some stuff on my book as well, that in some senses he's a tragic figure, because if only he'd had, you know, a father who was kinder to him perhaps, or if only his love story had not, say his love story had turned out okay, for example, he could have actually been a great man, because he had the capability, you know, to do a lot. But unfortunately, because of, you know, the twists of fate, his capability was used in a negative direction, which makes him, in a sense, a tragic figure.
How long did it take you to write this book?
Yeah, this book took some time. So it's been a little more than 2 years since the previous book. So, yeah. So, this is the longest break I've had between books.
And this happens to be your darkest mythological retelling so far.
Yes, certainly, certainly. And my readers tend to agree too. That is very dark.
How was this period of having Raavan constantly play on your mind?
He's a very dark, anger-filled guy. So that obviously impacts you. Because as a writer, you spend a lot of time with the character. You feel his emotions. You hear his thoughts. And what most historical fiction or mythological fiction writers will tell you is that we see 100, and what we write in the book is only 5 or 10. Because you can't possibly put everything down. We end up seeing a lot. We end up feeling a lot. So that obviously has a, you know, an impact on the mind of the author. So I've said this before also, I'm glad the book is over. So.
But did you empathize with the character even before you had started writing this book, or this understanding of the character grew deeper and so did your empathy for the guy?
More than empathy, I think it was more understanding, that you can understand where he's coming from and what is driving him. And sometimes one feels bad for him. Sometimes one feels like, Moron, what are you doing? You're making things worse for yourself. you know, but one can get where he comes from because, you know, he is not unaware of how capable he is. He knows he is brilliant. And so therefore he feels that it is his right to be at the top. It is his right to get respect and obeisance from everyone around him. And if he doesn't get it, to wo cheen ke lega. You know, that's his attitude. And that only makes things worse for him, right? It's the spiral of an ego. And that's one of the key things one can learn from Raavan, that even if you have his fearsome capabilities, if you can't control your ego, you're only going to make things worse for yourself. So being humble is not you being nice to someone else. It's you being nice to yourself. It's in your own selfish interest to not let your ego get out of hand. You shouldn't have zero ego. That's not good either. Balance is always good. If you have zero ego, zero anger, you usually become a doormat. People walk all over you. You need a little bit of ego to have some strength in your spine. But if your ego goes out of control, yeah, you'll end up like it.
So who finally killed Raavan? Ram, Sita, Lakshman?
You're going to have to wait for the fourth
any
book.
Any new
no?
character?
You're going to have to wait for the fourth book for that. At least my interpretation of it. But in the traditional versions, there are many interpretations. In the Valmiki Ramayana, Lord Ram kills him. In the Adbhut Ramayana, the main Ravan, the elder Ravan, is killed by Lady Sita. In the Jain version of the Ramayana, Lord Lakshman kills him. So there are many interpretations.
Amish, allow me to quote from Rig Veda. Ekam Sat Bauda, Ekam Sat Vipraha Bauda Vadanti.
From the Asya Vamasya hymn, yes.
Yes. Which essentially means, if you'd like to explain it to the readers.
Truth is one, but the wise men speak it as many.
Yeah, and the great sages call it by different names. Tell me something, don't you think that this freedom that we have as individuals to interpret the truth howsoever it is that we want to, doesn't this in a way refrain us from actually understanding the truth? Because it completely depends on, you know, one's own judgment, one's own level of maturity.
Good question. Very good question. Very smart question. The best answer to this is from another hymn in the Rig Veda itself, the Nasadiya Sukta. It's a creation hymn, you know, so therefore, you know, like many creation hymns in scriptures, it thinks, where did the universe come from? It just thinks and explores that. The best part about this hymn is the last few lines. It says that, how can even the gods know how creation happened? Because even they were created after creation happened, correct? How can even the gods know how creation happened? Because even they were created after creation happened. Perhaps the only one who knows is the one most high. They use the term Adhyaksha. Perhaps the only one who knows is the one most high, or perhaps even he doesn't know. Okay. Now see the philosophy at the heart of the Nasadiya Sukta, that nobody knows what the truth is. Not even God, not even the highest god or goddess. Nobody knows what the actual truth is. So therefore, you have to, if they don't know, how can we be sure that we know what the truth is? All we know is our truth. Okay. So if you actually imbibe that as our ancestors did, you automatically become much more open-minded. Because moment you get into a culture that there is one truth and I know the truth, the natural corollary is, if you don't agree with my truth, I will attack you. Correct. That's a natural corollary that happens. But when you accept that there are multiple truths, you naturally become liberal. More importantly, you naturally become inquisitive. Because you're interested in your truth, someone else comes in with a different thing. Hey, let me try and learn that too. There was a reason why India was the hotbed of innovation for most of human history. The reason was this inquisitive attitude. Just to give you a perspective, the number of non-printing press manuscripts that exists today, which gives you an idea of the knowledge production of our ancient culture, that exists today of Sanskrit, in the Sanskrit language, according to the National Manuscript Mission, is 3 million. That is more than the rest of the entire world combined. The number of Greek non-printing press manuscripts, which is the mother culture of Europe, only 20,000. Ours, 3 million. There was a reason why our ancestors produced so much knowledge. They were so smart. They were so innovative. It wasn't just spirituality. Mathematics, science, metallurgy, navigation, astronomy. Because they didn't get into this thing of there is one truth. Moment you do that, your mind closes. And if you have this, then does it matter what the one truth is? You'll keep searching for the truth. And through that, gain knowledge. It's a long answer.
No,
but I hope you got a point, yeah.
Your book was rejected by some 20 Indian publishers, but mostly stating that mythology doesn't quite interest young readers. Your success over the years has proven otherwise. How would you define Indian readers, the youth, the young generation of readers?
I think this is a fantastic generation because in many ways they are more like our ancient Indians than their parents, because they are willing to question everything. And that attitude is truly close to our ancient culture. Vedic Sanskrit, the language of our ancestors, didn't have a translation for the English word blasphemy. They didn't have that concept, so the word wasn't there. These guys are willing to question, right? Which is good, which is our core culture. I believe they are, you know, there's this fallacy that's spoken about that the youth of today aren't interested in our culture. I don't think that's true. I think they are. But they want to absorb our culture in their own idiom, and nothing wrong with that. Yeah, you know, all of us, because this has been a rich tradition in India, we keep reinterpreting our myths, keeping the soul of the old, but adding in something of the new age. So we've forgotten this tradition for the last few centuries. It's being, revived now. So I am very hopeful of this generation. It's a much more confident generation also than my generation was. I'm 44. So many of us, when we met Westerners, there was still a little bit of insecurities inside. One doesn't find that in the younger generation at all.
Do you think the education system is failing them?
So I think they have the the merit and the abilities. But our education system, frankly, no other word for it, it sucks. It is completely disconnected from Indian realities. In terms of capabilities, all it does is rote learning, which is terrible. Completely left brain focused. It's a model that was developed in Prussia some 200, 250 years ago, which the British bought out here. And we've just stuck with it and we've destroyed our own ancient education system, which had lasted till the British times. Which tried to marry the left and the right brain, which now modern Western education is trying to do that. So one, in terms of capability, secondly, in terms of connection to our roots and our culture, the education system does nothing on that. So we need big reforms, and those of us who love India have to keep screaming loudly about this so that something will change in this. We need to reconnect our education system to our roots. We need to teach more of Indian things in there. Indian texts, Indian literature, Indian sciences, Indian medicine. We teach very little of that. Almost none, actually.
You've spent over a decade being a writer now. How have you evolved as a writer and more so as a human being?
As a writer, I think that question is best answered by my readers. Hopefully you guys will think I've evolved, hopefully. In terms of as a human being, I think there's been a 180 degree turn in my character as compared to what I was like when I was a banker. I was very aggressive, very competitive, very angry most of the time, shouting and screaming a lot. I'm still competitive, some things will never change, but I have calmed down a lot, that truly, often calmness is seen as weakness. It's not. Actually, it gives you a core strength to handle any of the ups and downs of life, which are inevitable. Yeah, shit happens. It will happen. But if you're calm and centered inside, you're able to handle them. And that's the greatest blessing my books have had on me, that my character has changed by 180 degrees.
What was more difficult for you to work on, the Shiva trilogy when you just entered the world of book writing, or the Ram Chandra series when you are a great, successful author today with huge expectations.
Most difficult. No, when I'm writing, I don't really think about how it will work, what readers will think of it.
Expectations don't burden.
Anyway, I just cut off completely when I'm writing. But my most difficult book to write, certainly till now, was Raavan, Enemy of Aryabhatta. And that wasn't because of any because of anything in the writing world or the reading world. My own personal issues. So it was a difficult phase. And Raavan as a character was also a very troubling character. So maybe that's why this was the most difficult book to write.
And how long shall we have to wait for the next
release? Not as long as you had to wait for this book. So I've started work already.
Okay.
Yeah, it'll be out soon. The fourth book.
It should hit the stands by when?
Give me a year and a half.
Year and a half still.
Yeah. Okay. Year and a half is not bad, yeah.
You don't know.
It's like 400, kind of, 450 page
it's
books.
It's really tough to stop reading your books and then just keep waiting for the books
like 100,000 words. It takes time, yaar. Taras khao, yaar.
Amish, it was really lovely talking
to you.
We really, really look forward to the next release.
Thank you
so much.